Thyroid surgery in children doesn't occur very commonly, so you need to go to a place that has a thyroid surgeon that does this frequently. We define that as a surgeon who is performing thyroid surgeries in children and adolescents at least 30 times a year.
We decided best to go with someone who was very specific in performing that type of surgery, and really, if we were going to do that, we had to come here at CHOP.
I was really scared at first, but then when I met Dr. Adzick and he went, sat me down and talked about everything, I felt more comfortable knowing that mine was going to be in his hands. And it was all basically the doctors themselves, meeting them helped a lot.
Well, there are many different approaches to patients with thyroid disease who need surgery. For instance, there are those patients with Graves' disease, with large goiters, who for whatever reason need an operation, usually because they can't be controlled well medically. And those children require a total thyroidectomy.
So we remove 98% of the thyroid gland, 99% of the thyroid gland, with the hopes that we make the patient hypothyroid. We want to remove as much of the thyroid gland as safely possible so that they need to be put on thyroid hormone replacement.
Hi, good morning. I'm Ari Wancho from Anesthesia. How are you?
The anesthesiology team is very crucial before surgery as well as during surgery, calming the patient's fears, explaining everything so that they really understand what's going on, as well as providing the appropriate anesthesia during the surgical procedure.
Once the patient is anesthetized, the patient is positioned at an angle as far as your torso goes, and your head is back and your neck is extended. And the wound that's made for the operation is a sideways wound, because that allows good exposure of the thyroid gland, and it also follows the skin lines in the neck to give the most cosmetically appealing healing process. And then there are strap muscles in front of the thyroid gland, and we push those muscles aside to expose the butterfly. In the course of doing the operation and removing either one side of the butterfly or the entire butterfly, it's important that I find and protect certain structures. First of all, two nerves. They're called the recurrent laryngeal nerves. There's one on each side. They run right in the groove between the windpipe, which is called the trachea, and the esophagus, which is the food tube behind. And those nerves come up from the chest and they run up to where the vocal cords are in the voice box, which is just above the thyroid gland. And those nerves are about the size, depending on the age of the patient, of an angel hair pasta strand. And they're very delicate, and frequently it will abut the thyroid gland, so we need to peel the thyroid gland off of those nerves, one or both sides.
Those nerves are nerves that actually control the voice box, and so if you have damage on both sides, then a patient will have significant breathing problems to a point that they would need a tracheostomy. Or if the damage is not to both sides or problem with the nerve, sometimes it can be permanent enough where it causes hoarseness.
That occurs very infrequently, but when it does occur, it's a very debilitating process. And it's something, again, that should increase someone's concern of who they're sending the patient to as far as surgery, because that really needs to be avoided in the best interest of long-term care for that patient.
The second important structures are parathyroid glands, and they are usually four in number. Two are on the top, two are at the bottom. There can be anatomic variability as far as where they are. They frequently share blood supply with the thyroid gland, and they sometimes need to be peeled off the thyroid gland. For surgeons who operate on children with thyroid disease, it's important to have a sort of hand-in-glove relationship with the pediatric pathologist.
Sometimes we will receive parathyroid glands or tissue that is suspicious for being parathyroid, and we can do an intraoperative consultation, a frozen section, to determine whether or not that's actually what they are, or whether they're thyroid or lymph nodes or connective tissue.
Once we're finished with the thyroid portion of the operation, those muscles in the front are put back together, and then it's very important to close the wound in layers using absorbable sutures that will dissolve once the child is healed. So really the only thing that's on the wound are little steri-strips running sideways along the wound. And thyroid wounds, for the most part, heal beautifully. initially, they may be a little red and a little raised and a little firm, but that's normal because that's the healing ridge that occurs with any wound. Long term, in 6 to 9 months, it would be a very unusual circumstance in which there wasn't a very soft, flat, fine scar that might be barely noticeable.